Hachette Audio presents Still Life with Crows, written by Douglas Preston and Lincoln Child, read by Scott Brick.
Chapter 1. Medicine Creek, Kansas, early August, sunset. The great sea of yellow corn stretches from horizon to horizon under an angry sky. When the wind rises, the corn stirs and rustles as if alive, and when the wind dies down again, the corn falls silent. The heat wave is now in its third week, and dead air hovers over the corn in shimmering curtains. One road cuts through the corn from north to south, another from east to west. Where the two roads cross lies the town. Sad gray buildings huddle together at the intersection, gradually thinning along both roads into separate houses, then scattered farms, and then nothing. The creek, edged by scraggly trees, wanders in from the northwest, loops lazily around the town, and disappears in the southeast. It is the only curved thing in this landscape of straight lines. To the northeast rises a cluster of mounds surrounded by trees. A giant slaughterhouse stands south of the town, lost in the corn, its metal sides scoured by years of dust storms. The faint odor of blood and disinfectant drifts in a plume southward from the plant, riding the fitful currents of air. Beyond, just over the horizon, stand three gigantic grain silos, like a tall masted ship lost at sea. The temperature is exactly 100 degrees. Heat lightning flickers silently along the distant northern horizon. The corn is 7 feet high, the fat cobs clustered on the stalks. Harvest is 2 weeks away. Twilight is falling over the landscape. The orange sky bleeds away into red. A handful of streetlights blink on in the town. A black and white police cruiser passes along the main street, heading east into the great nothingness of corn, its headlights stabbing into the rising darkness. Some 3 miles ahead of the cruiser, a column of slow circling turkey vultures rides a thermal above the corn. They wheel down, then rise up again, circling endlessly, uneasily, rising and falling in a regular cadence. Sheriff Dent Hazen fiddled with the dashboard knobs and cursed at the tepid air that streamed from the vents. He felt the vent with the back of his hand, but it wasn't getting any cooler. The AC had finally bit the dust. He muttered another imprecation and cranked down the window, tossing out his cigarette butt. Furnace-like air boiled in, and the cruiser filled with the smell of late summer Kansas. Earth, corn stalks. He could see the circling turkey buzzards rise and dip. Rise and dip above the dying smear of sunset along the horizon. One ugly motherfucker of a bird, thought Hazen, and he glanced over at the long-barreled Winchester Defender lying on the seat beside him. With any luck, he'd get close enough to assist two or three of them into the next world. He slowed and glanced once again at the dark bird silhouetted against the sky. Why the hell aren't any of them landing? Turning off the main road, he eased the cruiser onto one of the many rutted dirt lanes that cut their way through the 1,000 square miles of corn surrounding Medicine Creek. He moved forward, keeping a watch on the sky until the birds were almost directly overhead. This was as close as he was going to get by car. From here, he'd have to walk. He threw the cruiser into park and, more out of habit than necessity, snapped on the light bar flashers. He eased his frame out of the cruiser and stood for a moment facing the wall of corn, drawing a rough hand across his stubbled chin. The rows went in the wrong direction, and it was going to be a bitch getting through them. Just the thought of shouldering through all those rows made him weary, and for a moment he thought about putting the cruiser in reverse and getting the hell back to town. But it was too late for that now. The neighbor's call had already been logged. Old Wilma Lowry had nothing better to do but look out her window and report the location of dead animals. But this was his last call of the day, and a few extra hours on Friday evening at least guaranteed him a long, lazy, boozy Sunday fishing at Hamilton Lake State Park. Hazen lit another cigarette, coughed, and scratched himself, looking at the dry ranks of corn. He wondered if it was somebody's cow who'd wandered into the corn and was now dead of bloat and greed. Since when was it a sheriff's responsibility to check on dead livestock? But he already knew the answer. Ever since the livestock inspector retired, there was nobody to take his place and no longer a need for one. Every year there were fewer family farms, fewer livestock, fewer people. Most people only kept cows and horses for nostalgic reasons. The whole county was going to hell. Realizing he'd put off the task long enough, Hazen sighed, hiked up his jangling service belt, slipped his flashlight out of its scabbard, shouldered the shotgun, and pushed his way into the corn. Despite the lateness of the hour, the sultry air refused to lift. The beam of his light flashed through the corn stalks, stretching before him like endless rows of prison bars. His nose filled with the smell of dry stalks, that peculiar rusty smell so familiar it was part of his very being. His feet crunched dry clods of earth, kicking up dust. It had been a wet spring, and until the heat wave kicked in a few weeks back, the summer sun had been benevolent. The stalks were as high as Hazen could ever remember, at least a foot or more over his head. Amazing how fast the black earth could turn to dust without rain. Once, as a kid, he'd run into a cornfield to escape his older brother and gotten lost. For 2 hours. The disorientation he'd felt then came back to him now. Inside the corn rows, the air felt trapped. Hot, fetid, itchy. Hazen took a deep drag on the cigarette and continued forward, knocking the fat cobs aside with irritation. The field belonged to Bustwell Agricon of Atlanta, and Sheriff Hazen could not have cared less if they lost a few ears because of his rough passage. Within 2 weeks, Agricon's huge combine harvesters would appear on the horizon, mowing down the corn, each feeding half a dozen streams of kernels into their hoppers. The corn would be trucked to the cluster of huge grain silos just over the northern horizon, and from there railed to feedlots from Nebraska to Missouri, to disappear down the throats of mindless, castrated cattle, which would in turn be transformed into big, fat, marbled sirloins for rich assholes in New York and Tokyo. Or maybe this was one of those gasohol fields where the corn wasn't eaten by man or even beast, but burned up in the engines of cars instead. What a world. Hazen bullied his way through row after row. Already his nose was running. He tossed his cigarette away, then realized he should probably have pinched it off first. Hell with it. 1,000 acres of the damn corn could burn and Bustwell Agricon wouldn't even notice. They should take care of their own fields, pick up their own dead animals. Of course, the executives had probably never set foot in a real cornfield in their lives. Like almost everyone else in Medicine Creek, Hazen came from a farming family that no longer farmed. They had sold their land to companies like Bustwell Agricon. The population of Medicine Creek had been dropping for more than half a century, and the great industrial cornfields were now dotted with abandoned houses, their empty window frames staring like dead eyes over the billowy mane of crops. But Hazen had stayed. Not that he liked Medicine Creek particularly. What he liked was wearing a uniform and being respected. He liked the town because he knew the town, every last person, every dark corner, every nasty secret. Truth was, he simply couldn't imagine himself anywhere else. He was as much a part of Medicine Creek as Medicine Creek was a part of him. Hazen stopped suddenly. He swept his beam through the stalks ahead. The air, full of dust, now carried another smell, the perfume of decay. He glanced up. The buzzards were far above now, directly over his head. Another 50 yards and he would be there. The air was still, the silence complete. He unshouldered his shotgun and moved forward more cautiously. The smell of decay drifted through the rows, sweeter by the moment. Now Hazen could make out a gap in the corn, a clearing directly ahead of him. Odd. The sky had flamed its red farewell and was now dark. The sheriff raised his gun, eased off the safety with his thumb, and broke through the last corn row into the clearing. For a moment, he looked around in wild incomprehension. And then, rather suddenly, he realized what he was looking at. The gun went off when it hit the ground, and the load of double-aught buckshot blew by Hazen's ear. But the sheriff barely noticed. Chapter 2. 2 hours later, Sheriff Dent Hazen stood in approximately the same spot. But now the cornfield had been transformed into a gigantic crime scene. The clearing was ringed with portable sodium vapor lights that bathed the scene in a harsh white glow.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.